Anybody have any questions or comments on those minutes?
No.
Do I hear a motion?
Move that the meeting be approved as written.
Second.
All in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous? I think it's unanimous. Okay. For the record, since the last meeting, the Planning Board has received the following correspondence and other items. The Zoning Board minutes of August the 26th, 1997. Zoning News for August of 1997. A letter from B. Rich regarding the Rancourt Daycare. Letter from D. Barris regarding Rancourt Daycare. A letter from M. Moeller regarding Rancourt Daycare. A letter from B. Webster regarding Rancourt Daycare. A letter from E. Hunt regarding Rancourt Daycare. A letter from Carol Haas regarding the Dyer Pond Lot 1. And on the podium this evening were additional letters from Kiki O'Connell regarding the Rancourt Daycare, from Dr. S. Hershen, same project, Floyd Davies, Rosemary Flaherty, Betty Doolin, Philip Stanwood, and that's it. So, as you might expect from that recitation, the first item of business is the Rancourt Daycare Facility Site Plan, a request by Dana Rancourt and Lisa Manini for site plan review to operate a daycare facility at 111 Scott Dyer Road to be heard under Section 19-9-4, public hearing. Would the applicant like to step to the podium and give us a very short introduction to the project, and then we'll open the public hearing?
Good evening. My name is Lisa Manini. This is my fiance Dana Rancourt, and we live at 111 Scott Dyer Road, Cape Elizabeth. We are proposing to open a daycare home facility for seven or more children under the age of 16. We will target school-age children whose parents want to encourage and foster multiple opportunities for their child to interact with the residents of the Viking Nursing Facility directly across the street. In changing times and family structures which distance grandparents from grandchildren, we hope to provide more opportunities for intergenerational sharing. In addition to shared holiday programming, cross-generation visits, and an adopt-a-grandparent program, these school-aged children will be provided with equipment for planned group and individual activities, which will reflect the social, emotional, physical, and cognitive needs of this age group. The program shall allow time for individual self-directed enrichment activities when appropriate. The center's hours will be from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Monday through Friday. As the operator, I am currently enrolled in a child development class at SMTC. I am from a large family with 14 nieces and nephews and come with a lifelong love for being around children. A certified and knowledgeable child development specialist will be retained to assist in developing a varied and exciting enrichment program for the children, geared to their individual needs and skills. Opportunities to learn lifelong craft skills, interaction with their peers, and exposure to the world of computers will be available at our center. We have been before the Zoning Board, which gave us approval for a conditional use permit on June 24th. We're here tonight to present our proposed site improvements for your review. The parking and traffic patterns in and out of the driveway has been revised. The circular drive and the widening of the driveway from 12 feet to 18 feet, we believe, addresses the concerns brought up by the board at our workshop in August. The main entrance into the center will be through the existing garage, which will be renovated. We are proposing to remove the existing garage doors and install an entry from the driveway. The garage area will be the craft room equipped with two wash sinks, which we are proposing to install, as well as desks and work area. Windows and entry will be incorporated into the space previously occupied by the garage doors. In order to create a contiguous space, we are proposing to build an 8x8 addition to the back side of the house, which would connect the main house to the converted garage. Paved walkway and entrance for the home's occupants is being proposed. A media room where video, audio, computer, and other individual and group activities will take place as planned. The game room, which will contain board games, ping pong, and access to the fenced-in play area, is at the further end of the center. The fenced-in area being proposed will occupy approximately 1,500 square feet on the easterly side of the building facing Patricia Drive. A 5-foot-high wood stockade fence is planned for the outside play area, which will be equipped with various playground equipment appropriate for school-aged children. Except for the new wallboard, ceilings, flooring, and other cosmetic renovations to the basement, none of the existing partitions will be changed. Currently, there exists a sump pump, which is currently directed to flow directly into Scott Dyer Road. We propose to redirect this so we'll exit onto the lawn opposite the driveway, which pitches away from the house onto the lawn on the easterly side of the house. Outside lights are being proposed at the new entryway, as well as installing a new pole light. We are proposing a shingle-type sign, 2-foot by 3-foot, be placed on the lawn indicating the name, telephone number, and entrance to the center. There is one existing apple tree whose limbs impede sight distance on the right side of the driveway. We have proposed to trim these limbs back in order to get the full 500 feet of the side distance on the right. The left side distance over 800 feet. Sue Weatherby, who oversees the after-school program for the town of Cape Elizabeth, as well as coordinates school bus stops, has indicated that children will be picked up and dropped off at the end of our driveway. Our home is serviced by town water and sewer. The Portland Water District has assured us that our 3/4-inch water service is more than adequate to supply the water needs for a daycare center. We anticipate that there won't be an inordinate amount of solid waste generated by the center, mostly paper and craft supplies, which we will dispose of with our household waste at the town transfer station.
Thank you, Ms. Manini. I think at this time we would like to thank you for the introduction, and I'll open the public hearing at this time. Anybody who'd like to speak, come forward and tell us who you are and where you live and what you have to say.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, for giving me the opportunity to come here tonight. My name is Philip Stanwood. I do not live in Cape Elizabeth, but my wife Marjorie has been a resident of the Viking for 10 years. So in her behalf, I'm coming here to speak how I know she would want me to speak if she was able.
Excellent.
I just want to say, before I open, that I've known the Rancourt family for a number of years, and I think the Viking and the Crescent House are an asset to your community, and Dwayne Rancourt and his staff run a very high level place, and you are very fortunate to have this in this community. And my wife has the excellent care there. I can only say the very highest, and I just thought of a chance to throw that out so the people in the community who might not know so much about the Viking as I do, I just wanted to tell you, and they are really a credit to this community.
Thank you, Mr. Stanwood.
Tonight, I've come here to speak in behalf of Dana Rancourt in his quest for a nursery, as you've just heard, across the street. I've got to know Dana quite well in the last few years, and I'll tell you, anything that the Rancourt family does, they do it with style and class. And I'm certainly sure that in this project that they've taken on, there's been a big investment, as well as a lot of initiative, and most of all, their love for the children. But one of the most important things is that they want to have like an adopted grandparent program with the Viking and Crescent residents with these children. And I think that is a great thing. because I know they have done this with other places in the community, but it's more, it's a great to have it one of their own right across the street. And I don't think anybody has to fear anything about it being a problem, because this will be run on the highest level that's humanly possible, and it will be staffed well, and I am certainly, I know probably some of the people are worrying about some of the noise. Knowing Dana and the Rancroft family, that will be kept down to the very minimum. And I wish I was a resident of Cape Elizabeth and could say, could make a vote on this. But I came here voluntarily tonight. I just told Dana, I says, I stayed in town 3 hours longer so I could come here and speak to you. And I hope that my words of support for Dana and the Rancroft family and for the young lady who made a very good presentation, that you will take that all in very deep consideration and will accept it. Again, I thank you very much for letting me come here tonight, but I hope and pray that you will accept it. Again, this is a great project and it will be a great asset to this community.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Stantwood. Anybody else wish to speak? Tell us what your name is and where you live.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. My name is Judy Harnois. I live at 42 Columbus Road in Cape Elizabeth, and I'm here to speak for Dana and for Lisa. I am a past employee of the Viking Crescent House at, actually regretfully saying that, I'm in the process of moving. I have been with the both of them, hearing about their plans and listening to them and their passion for this daycare. I think if we can focus on the passion and how they feel and what they want to do comes from the heart. I truly believe with their knowledge, with their care, this would be a very positive thing. I think it would be a positive thing in the fact of the elderly. I am for that. I have a passion for the elderly. I also have a passion for children. Working at the Crescent House in the Viking, I saw firsthand how well-run that facility is. It's a very respected facility, a very caring facility. And I know a lot of that comes from the father who developed this facility many years ago and has gone into his sons, both of them. I see a lot of pre-thought, thinking of others. They truly understand what has been projected and what they're up against. And knowing this, I think they've devised a plan to help others and help their community, their surrounding neighbors. I also want to say that this gentleman before me took my speech, so I'm now trying to think of other things to say, but it's very hard for me to say anything negative. There's nothing but respect for both of them, and if you do listen to them and look over their plans, as I've said before, working there, I was worked there for about 2.5 years. I just truly feel deep down in my heart that this would be a positive thing, and if I did have small children, I would be the first one to sign up. Let's say 10 years ago, I had a daycare myself in South Carolina. I know what he's up against, but I truly feel if you feel his passion and her passion and know the care, we do need good daycare. That is so important. It is so important to Cape Elizabeth as a family community. I have seen this. I have seen bad daycare. I have seen negative daycare. And I know deep down in my heart that we would be blessed having them be in charge of our children, and I hope you all take that, and I thank you.
Thank you very much for coming this evening. Anybody else wish to comment? See lots of faces out there. Don't be bashful.
I'm James E. Murray, Jr. of 8 Patricia Drive in Cape Elizabeth. We are one of the abutters of the property that joins the proposed daycare center. Let me say this. We're not against the concept. We have, in fact, we supported the Viking Nursing Home when they asked for votes many years ago. We are not against the concept. We believe in the interaction of young people with old people. However, we feel that 111 Scottsdale Road is not the place for the daycares. We recognize, we think the Viking, and I've said this, and you have our letter of August 3rd, which, with all our concerns, and we greatly appreciate this opportunity to be heard. In our letter, we mentioned that we feel that Viking Nursing Home would be the ideal location for this type of a daycare center. If you people, and I'm sure you have all gone by the area in question, if you recognize that the Viking Nursing Home has two exits and combined exits and entrances. Across the street is the Brennan driveway, then there's Patricia Drive, then this is the proposed circular driveway for the daycare center. This, in our opinion, will create a tremendous amount of congestion during the busy drop-off and pick-up of children and or adults, older people, crossing the road. Yes, we have heard that they will bust them across the street, and that's fine. But there's always that potential problem. We recognize that the Zoning Board of Appeals has approved the proposal. I don't have a problem with the daycare proposal. I have a problem with the area location. The traffic study that was taken 7 years ago, in my opinion, and I'm not going to challenge you individuals, leaves a lot to be desired, as I spelled out in my letter of August 3rd. And I think you have letters from the Ingalls, who unfortunately cannot be here today because they were called out of town. As far as the value concern, I think one of the issues is that the proposed use will not adversely affect the value of adjacent properties. I've talked to agents and brokers in real estate, and they have informed me they would not put it in writing for political reasons. I suppose if I hired them and paid them, yes, they would, and they would be here tonight. However, I did not think that was necessary. They advised me that a daycare center of this type in a residential area can have a negative impact on the values of surrounding properties. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to make problems for the Rand Courts or what have you, or Liza Menini. I know they're working hard, and as the girl said, it's a very passionate thing. And I respect that. However, I'm telling you, it's a tough area. Just yesterday, we followed a car into Patricia Drive, and the lady did not know where to go. She ended up down our driveway, and she just sat there momentarily until we got out, and we beckoned her on and gave her direction how to get out of the Patricia Drive. We can see in this configuration that there's a potential for a great traffic problem, both pedestrian and traffic in that one immediate area. Now, I know I've been a resident here for Cape Elizabeth for 41 years. I know that you will give equal concern and weight to our concerns as you have to the proposal. And I wish them well. However, we do not feel that 111 Scottsdale Road is the proper place for this type of a daycare, and we do support the daycare concept. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Murray. Anybody else wish to speak?
Good evening. My name is Jeff Thorak, and I live on 16 Patricia Drive with my wife, and that's directly behind the Rand Courts. I respect the Rand Court's decision for a daycare. I respect their passion. I, too, am an educator at the high school. And my concern is, I understand, I don't necessarily oppose what's happening here, but my concern is the noise. And I was wondering if there was any kind of discussion or any kind of compromise. Please correct me if I'm wrong or inappropriate at time. This is very new to me. I'm a first-time homeowner, and this is a new process. So I was wondering if there could be any kind of discussion on some kind of a privacy fence or just something that might be able to at least baffle maybe some of the noise or just deter or that I'm just concerned. I have a couple of dogs. I'm just starting a family. I have a newborn son, and I plan on having more children, and I'm a little concerned about the noise. So if there's any kind of discussion that could be heard or started.
That's fine. That's what these public hearings are for.
And I thank you very much for holding the hearing. I appreciate that. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you for speaking. Anybody else in the audience have anything to say? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. I'm Ruth Brennan. I'm at 107 Scottsdale Road, right on the other corner of Patricia. I don't really have anything new to add. I do agree with my neighbor, Jim Murray. I've also sent a letter in the past with other concerns. I know they are addressing some of the traffic problems. Originally, they said they were going to drop them off at Brentwood, and that was an issue with me because they would cross in front of the house. There's no walk, or there's really not any walking space there. So they did address that. But of course, I'm right across from the service entrance of the Viking, so I just feel like I'm getting surrounded by commercial properties when, you know, it had been, of course, years ago, just residential and farmland and so forth. The Viking is there now, and there's a lot of commercial traffic and trucks delivering all day long, bakery trucks, you know, things that are needed there, trash removal, things like that. So it's constant trucks coming in and out of that entrance that is down from the proposed daycare. But I guess my problem with it is another business, let's say, right there in that area is troubling to me, and the concern of property value is a concern for me also, because I really feel surrounded now. And of course, talking about grandparenting, many of us are grandparents. We certainly, you can't be against intergenerational activities. I mean, let's face it, this is a wonderful thing. But I think, you know, perhaps it could be in another area, or had it been added to the back of the Viking or something like that. But taking this, that had always been a private home, and now we're going to have a real full-fledged business there, is really troubling to me. And I realize, I appreciate the opportunity to speak. I know this was probably all addressed at the zoning and probably more properly addressed there, but I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you, Ms. Brennan, for coming and talking to us. Anybody else have anything to say? No? Okay, without further ado,
I'd like to speak.
Mr. Rancourt.
My name is Dwayne Rancourt. I'm the operator of the Viking Nursing Facility across the street from 111 Scottsdale Road. I happen to be the father of Dana and the future father-in-law, Lisa, who's applying for your planning board review and approval. I'd be remiss if I didn't come up and at least make an appeal beyond what the appeal was that Lisa made, that we have 120 Cape Elizabeth residents living at the Viking. We have 60 in the nursing home side and 60 in the assisted living side. I think it's important for you to understand that we're not trying to take away from the neighborhood. We're not trying to cause problems for the neighbors. We have tried to be good citizens as we sit where we sit. We believe we're a quiet industry. I believe that the applicant and what the applicant is trying to do is to bring a service again to people who are citizens of the town of Cape Elizabeth. There are 120 citizens across the street from this facility that will benefit greatly from having the opportunity to have more interaction with young children, and it is one of the greatest pleasures they have. As I'm sure all of you who have elderly parents or elderly relatives know, the people they relate to best as they get older are the young people. These people, and unfortunately, because of the function of their age, have lost contact with a lot of their own friends. And they make very good friends with young people. And I think that some of the concerns that have been addressed by some of our neighbors you know, we've tried to address, Dana's tried to address in the application. It's going to be a safe facility. It's going to be a facility that Cape Elizabeth can be very proud of. And I think it's going to certainly enhance the life and the pleasures that the residents across the street will have for many, many years to come. And I appreciate your consideration and the opportunity to speak to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rancourt. Anybody else wish to speak? Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Alan Roper. I'm not a resident of Cape Elizabeth, but I've been a friend of Maud Heideman for several years. Her mother is at the Crescent House. I was a prior resident of Cape Elizabeth and had the opportunity of growing up here. So thank you very much for the time and the opportunity. I don't know whether it's a fair way of saying it, but I'll create it. We've often heard of a win-win situation. And I think that we've all recognized that, yes, the young people will win with the opportunity of being with more senior people. And very certainly the senior people will win by having young people being so close at hand. But this is a win-win-win situation. And before I speak to the third win, I certainly recognize the concern that the property owners have. As a property owner in another town, I would certainly feel the same way and certainly have reservations. And I'll come to that in just a moment. But the third win is the town of Cape Elizabeth. If you work with young people, and I recognize that one of the earlier speakers, the gentleman who is employed at the high school, young people of age coming up through 12 to 16 have a variety of extracurricular activity that they become involved in. Not always is it school related. Some of it's not always positive. But if they have a positive environment to go to, boy, that's a hallelujah. Not just for the parents, but for the town. This is a positive for the town also, in that I think that probably some of you have had the opportunity of going into the Crescent House and the Viking, and what a super facility that is. Not only the way that it's staffed and run, but the way that it looks. And as a property owner, coming back to that, whenever you have a new neighbor, you're never sure what that neighbor's going to bring with them. Property value is always a point of concern when someone else moves in, and especially from when they're away, so to speak. But when you have a neighbor that's pretty much already proven themselves, wishing to take a property and to do something kind of neat and creative with it, how many of us have heard of daycare for this age young people in the greater Portland area? To me, it's a new. And this is sharp. This is neat. This is a win opportunity. And the land, I can't imagine that probably the property value would depreciate. If anything, I would think that very likely that it would go the other direction. And I do hear the concern about the drop-off, the added traffic in the area. I recognize that concern. But boy, there's so many other aspects to this concept winning. I congratulate the people with the ideas, and I congratulate you people having such a neat opportunity to make a very worthwhile decision. Thank you very much for the time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Roper. Anybody else interested in speaking to this issue?
I yes. wanted to let the board know that John Ingalls wrote you a letter, and he came in to see me a couple of times, and he just said that you have his letter, you know what his comments are, but he is out of town, was out of town at the last meeting, and he appreciated the opportunity to hold the public hearing even though he can't be here.
Thank you, Maureen. Okay, if there are no further participants in the public hearing, I will close it and ask the applicant, Ms. Manini, or do you or Mr. Rancourt have any response to the comments that have been made at the public hearing? All right, then thank you. I'll open the discussion with respect to the board. Anybody got any questions, comments, concerns? Mr. Azzolino.
Yeah, Madam Chairman, I would like to go on record and make a statement, and then perhaps you would ask you to clarify. I would like to say that it is not in the purview of this board to make operational, moral, emotional, or citizenship issues, or to pass on the value added of a daycare facility in Cape Elizabeth, notwithstanding how, please don't misinterpret that as a negative comment. Those are issues that are beyond the purview of this board. Our job is to deal with issues that the planning board is responsible for dealing with. And I'm a little concerned about being placed in a position where potentially our decision, whatever it may be, is viewed as anything other than an objective evaluation of the requirements that are placed on us as a board in this town. The zoning board has made a decision that has said that a daycare facility can go here on this site. We cannot reverse that. That's not within our purview to reverse that. However, it is in our purview to set requirements consistent with ordinance, to make sure that the rules and regulations are followed. And I would like to very strongly emphasize that from my standpoint, and I have some concerns about this issue, that it has nothing to do with anything other than those very objective facts and circumstances. And I'm concerned that the public or those in the audience or those who have spoken might view it any other way. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Azzolino, and thank you for reminding me that I think perhaps it would be a good idea, because this doesn't come before us all the time, where we have something that has gone first before the planning board and then comes before us, if I could ask Maureen O'Mara, the town planner, to perhaps give us basically what amounts to a short tutorial on how we got the project, what the zoning board paid attention to, and what our requirements are with respect to review.
Certainly. The site is located in the RC, the Residence C district, and under that district, a daycare facility is what is considered a conditional use. That means that if it meets certain conditions, it will be allowed to exist. In order to get approval for a conditional use, you have to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals, and they review that use under the conditional use standards. That was done under this project, and it received a majority approval. After it received its conditional use approval, it's also required to get site plan review. That's basically to make sure that the site is designed so that it doesn't create a hazard to the public, traffic hazard, noise, landscaping, buffering, lighting, signage, those types of issues. So the planning board has been asked to review this using the site plan review standards. Those standards are found in section 19-9-5 of the zoning ordinance. The board does not have the authority to pass on whether or not a use is appropriate, either in this case or in any other case. That is the purview of the zoning board.
Thank you. Any further comments from the board or questions? Mr. Emery.
Madam Chair, these types of projects are a little unusual. We don't normally have a developer and three or four hired guns coming in with a big, thick set of plans and engineering drawings. But I would just like to point out for the record that what we have in our package is a plan labeled a site boundary, a site plan, and a standard boundary survey. And my understanding is we haven't received any updates of this plan. This is all we have from our last meeting.
That is correct. There's been nothing further.
Then I think there needs to be several things addressed on this plan as a condition of review. At the previous meeting, it was mentioned that the Rancourts own the adjacent parcel, which gets deeper within the Patricia Drive neighborhood and directly has the ability to affect several abutters directly. And therefore, and there was some discussion that they may indeed sell that as a house lot. We suggested, or at least I suggested at the last meeting, that their parking area be set back 10 to 15 feet with some sort of a buffer in case the parcel, adjacent parcel, is sold as a single-family house. The plan refers to transplanted shrubs. Transplanted is a past tense. I don't know that they have been transplanted. So it should be clearly indicated whether those plants exist on the site and they're being transplanted to those locations, or they're indeed new shrubs that are going to be planted there. And one of the great concerns with transplanting anything is that you don't get a guarantee from anyone unless you're really willing to pay a lot of money, a lot more than the shrubs are typically worth. So I would suggest that if this approval is indicating that there will be shrubs placed as a buffer to the proposed use, buffering the existing neighborhood, that as a condition of this approval, that if the transplanted shrubs, if they're moved from other locations on site, don't survive, that they be replaced with new shrubs. The zoning board, in its condition of approval, indicated the need for some sort of a walk, and it's not clear to me where that is, but evidently there'll be children dropped off at the corner of Patricia Drive and Scott Dyer Road.
Mr. Rancourter, if you're going to respond, hang on until we get through with comments. We'll ask you to respond.
In any event, if they were to be dropped off at Patricia Drive, according to the zoning board review, there needs to be a walk indicated on the plan. I think, given the strong relationship that's being promoted between the Viking Community Center nursing facility and this single-family residence, that there should be a clearly marked crosswalk and signage. Scott Dyer Road has become a very busy road. It's the only primary access to the dump from everyone that lives from Wells Road or Spurwink Avenue toward the ocean, probably the better portion of the east part of Cape Elizabeth. And indeed, if there were any cars parked in front or a bus stopped in front, it would be unlikely that two cars could get by there. I think that's, is it my understanding that this fence is going to be a wood fence? It's not going to be a 5-foot chain link fence?
Stockade.
Okay, thank you. Lastly, the plan indicates a 15-foot turning radius exiting the widened driveway heading west on Scott Dyer Road, and yet indicates a sharp right-hand turn. It seemed to me that the driveway should have a symmetrical entrance configuration because cars heading west on Scott Dyer needing to turn right into the site would need the same radius as anyone exiting. And I just want to be sure that any conditions in terms of days of operation, limitations of time that were placed on the zoning board ride with the site plan approval as well. In fact, if this is the plan that the is being submitted as part of our site plan review, I think it would be advisable that those notes be added as general notes to this plan indicating what the zoning board review stipulated in terms of conditions. That's all. Thank you.
Mr. Azzolino.
Couple of comments. And I'd like to focus first on the traffic issue, and it's a concern that I have as it relates to Scott Dyer Road. We're relying on a 1990 traffic survey, is my understanding, to support the fact that there would be no negative impact of this project. However, I think there have been at least two significant events that have taken place since then, one being the addition to the Viking itself a few years ago, and perhaps more importantly, the Dominicus Crossing project, which is a major development that recently approved. While that is on Wells Road, we know will indirectly impact Scott Dyer, because anybody coming out of that project to get into the center of town has to come down Wells and then ultimately up Scott Dyer Road. And I believe that's 90, Maureen, correct me if I'm wrong, how many new homes are we putting in there? Whatever it is, 90-some new homes. And I would be very concerned that we approve this project in the absence of a formal traffic study, an updated traffic study that took those things into consideration. Secondly, when we talked the last time, it is my understanding that there are no current restrictions on the numbers of or age of children that would be in the facility, except by virtue of the license. And if I don't remember, and perhaps you could refresh our memory, there was a cap on that that I guess the state licensing agency puts on it. And would ask if the applicant would consider formally putting a cap on that as a requirement of approval. And I don't remember the exact numbers, but I want to say
there was 12 as a cap on the zoning approval.
In the zoning approval, is that carry? So they cannot have more than 12. The zoning approval carries over, so
right.
There can be no more than 12. Then I'll drop
right.
The issue.
Unless they go back to the zoning board.
Okay, well then I would repeat that I am right, that there be a stipulation that there be no more than 12 children in the facility, which is, I think, was the stated intent of the applicants, and I think that would help mitigate some of these other concerns. And the final comment I would make is that with respect to the adjacent homeowners, that given the nature of the project, that there be consideration given to fencing the property, particularly with respect to the neighbor adjacent on the north side, if I've got my directions right, to mitigate both sight and noise interference.
Would the applicant like to respond to that?
Excuse me. In regard to the conditional use, I believe, that was passed by the zoning board about the sidewalk, that was before the sidewalk across the lawn, that was before we knew that the children would be dropped off in the driveway. They were thinking if they were dropped off on Brentwood or on Patricia Drive, then we should have a sort of walkway where there isn't one in front of the house. But since this children would be walking right into the driveway, the bus would stop right there. We wouldn't be on the front lawn, and that's why they wanted a driveway put up for that. As far as limiting our number of children, I've been working very close with Mr. Rancourt, and I would like to defer that answer to him.
In preparation to coming to this public hearing tonight, both Lisa and Dana indicated a feeling of intimidation by this board. And I felt that, you know, I said, let me answer any questions you might feel uncomfortable about. I think you have in your packet the fact that the Viking has given its financial support for this project. And we're talking about a daycare facility that has conditional use, and you're asking it to be limited to 12. There's no way that I can see why that should happen. The facility is large enough to accommodate more than 12. They're coming in and asking for...
It's already been established by the zoning board. This board, it's in the minutes of the zoning board meeting that the population will be capped at 12 children.
Then why is that an issue now?
He was asking the question.
Well, if it's not an issue, why would you ask the question?
Well, I would like to see as a condition of the planning board approval. You can go back to the zoning board and get approval.
Correct.
To increase 12.
That's correct. And so could we do that with the planning board? Thousands of dollars have already been spent on this application, and you're asking that to be repeated in some future time?
Yes, I am. I'm asking that...
Excuse me, I'd just appreciate it if you would keep your voice down and not be so argumentative. I think we can...
I don't mean to be argumentative. I mean to be very blunt.
Well, then let me respond very bluntly. As a planning board member, I am asking that a requirement of approval be that you limit the facility to 12 children. That's the requirement I'm asking for.
If you could explain why that's necessary, I would be very willing to listen.
I'd be very happy to explain it, Mr. Ancourt. And you need to lower your defenses a little bit, because I take offense at the fact that the applicants feel a little intimidated by this board. We have tried to explain to you and to them what our purview is. But I also take umbrage with an applicant trying to intimidate this board.
I'm not trying to intimidate. I'm trying
Very
to answer.
Very good. Then we understand
question,
each other.
Question
then,
the judgment.
Then we understand each other, and then let me explain the answer. As one member of this planning board, I am concerned with the traffic issues. As one member of this planning board, I am concerned with issues raised by a number of citizens. And limiting the number of children in the facility would, in my view, tend to mitigate the traffic issues greatly. And it would also tend to mitigate, I believe, the concerns of some of the neighborhood. If you have 12 children in this facility, it's a lot different than having 40 or whatever the number is. That reduces the impact of the traffic or any other impact. And that's the logic of the request. Now, how you deal with it is entirely up to you.
With all due respect, sir, if we have to go back to the zoning board to get it changed at the zoning board level beyond 12, and we have to go back to the state to get licensing beyond a certain number, I ask, without intimidation, just a citizen trying to determine what it is that we're trying to arrive at, why would you want us to voluntarily give up that opportunity and force ourselves back to the planning board at some future time when we're already forced back to the zoning board?
Let me respond, and then please, my understanding is I can't speak for the zoning board. I can only speak for the planning board. So I'm not trying to pass off the response. What I'm trying to say is I would like to see as a requirement in this approval that if you plan to exceed 12, that you come back to this board and seek approval to do that. I can't speak for the zoning board.
Thank you, Mr. Azalina. Anybody got any concerns or questions over here? Yes.
I have a concern about this issue also, in that approval from the zoning board does not automatically then require further review by the planning board.
Absolutely.
We have not been presented with a parking lot which accommodates 40 cars, and I believe we have been presented with a parking lot and a pickup and drop-off scheme that accommodates the traffic generated by 12 children. If this approval is not contingent on linked to this design that we're presented with, I don't see how I have any choice but to vote against this project if it is not tied to the plans and the activity that's been presented to us.
Well, I guess I would say that, or stronger, that it would be irresponsible of us not to be specific about what it is that we are approving if we do approve the project. So, are there any other comments or questions from board members on any aspect of the application?
I would just like to point out for the record, this board is faced with another application for 45 students. 45 students. That's 1.5 classrooms, regular classrooms at an elementary school. This use can flop into any neighborhood in any area of Cape Elizabeth. Someone can be sitting thinking they're in a very quiet single-family neighborhood with no sidewalks, and when suddenly someone comes forth with a 12-student daycare center that may start with 6 students. Many of us grew up in families with more children than that in a single family. Typically today, however, most people grow up in a family with 2 to 3, maybe even 4 children. So to say that there's not much difference between 12 and 20 or 40 or whatever the number is, and we have seen more than 40 now as an application, is a significant difference. And I think as a resident of Cape Elizabeth, if I'm being told that by the zoning board that this use is okay because it's only 12 students, and I know at the back of my mind that perhaps it could grow to something far more than that, then I think I have a very significant concern. I think that's a very big difference in dropping this type of use within an existing residential neighborhood. I would plead with the applicant, if the applicant has intentions of growing to 20, 30, 45 students, to please let us know at this time. And if indeed the applicant intends to use the adjacent property, let's plan this thing correctly and let's let the neighbors have informed input at this time. If this is a 10-year plan, if this isn't going to happen for 10 years, then no one knows what's going to happen in 5 years. But if this is something that you're really counting on and is going to make this thing economically viable, and you're anticipating doing this in the next couple of years, please let us know so we can look at this in the bigger scheme of things. I think in the long run it'll serve the applicant far better.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Is there any response from the applicant to that?
We're definitely not looking at it.
Would you come to the podium if you would, Mr. Rancourt?
We
just wanted to make sure that we didn't cut our own throats by saying yes, that we will limit it to 12. We're certainly not looking to get up to the 40 range. Obviously, our parking lot isn't going to accommodate for that many. But just because we don't know what the damage we could do today by saying that we'll agree to 12, that what it will do to us later on when we decide that we'd like to get to 14 or to 16. Not only that, to create a little more jobs for some other people to come in and help work in the daycare. So if it's going to put a limitation on us to say that yes, we'll keep it at 12, and that's basically the argument we got right now, is that if we say, okay, it's 12, are we ever going to be okay to have 14 or 16 or 18?
Is it true that your current plans are simply
12.
To have 12?
Just 12.
Do you have any plans for expansion in the foreseeable
future? Not right now, no, but we want to make sure that we're not cutting fingers off, despite, you know, especially today. You know, if we're going to get passed for our 12, that's what we want, and that's what we're going to work with. But if we can, I have no idea really to tell you that if we say, okay, we're on 12, we agree on 12, what it's going to be 5 years down the road if we'd like to put in 14 or 16. If we can accommodate that, are we going to be allowed to? See, we're not finding out from your side either if we're going to be stuck at 12 for the next 20 years. And if everybody moves out of the neighborhood and we end up buying the whole neighborhood out, are we going to be allowed to have 40? That's all I want to make sure of.
Well, you understand that the zoning board has restricted the current daycare application to 12.
Yes, we do now.
I don't intend to speak for the board until the board decides something, but if the planning board decides that it will restrict the children to 12, then anytime you wanted to expand in any way, it would require going back to the zoning board and coming back to the planning board.
Okay.
It would be a two-step process. It really is that straightforward.
No, we're working
whatever on restrictions there are, and there could be many different kinds of restrictions depending on what the board decides.
Okay.
You are constrained to operate within those restrictions,
well,
and if you need some changes, then you have to come back and talk to us. That's
okay.
Really, that's
good.
The way it works.
So we're not hurting ourselves okaying you right now that we will stay at 12. We're not hurting ourselves because we're going to have
you're
to
already
back.
Restricted by the zoning
okay.
board.
Okay, good. That's all we needed to know.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Concerns, questions from any other board members?
I think just one other item. With respect to the suggested minor changes to the plan, the buffering and so forth, we have a pile of letters both in favor of the project and from the neighbors, and I think this board endeavors to look at all the correspondence we get and listen to the public comment. And unless the board reacts or responds to concerns within existing neighborhoods of uses that are different than the surrounding single-family uses that people are accustomed to, then I think there's a real chance of loss of confidence in this planning board review process within site plan review. There were a couple of other issues that were raised. One was noise. 12 children playing outside with the buffering that we see and surrounded by a fence is something that we could hire 10 consultants to argue about back and forth, but I don't think is appropriate for a project of this scale. I feel fairly comfortable that given the distances that we're looking at, it's no more impacting than people playing near a playground, playing near Fort Williams and so forth. But if this project were to go to 25 to 40 students, then I think it's a whole different ballgame at that point. Same with traffic, same with a sense of a commercial operation. With concerns for property values, I live in a small neighborhood up in Brentwood, and I when I'm out working in the yard and so forth, we see people trolling the neighborhoods on weekends looking for houses. Many neighborhoods have several houses for sale in Cape Elizabeth. And clearly, people drive by with different intentions. People drive through neighborhoods like Brentwood, I think, who have young families who are looking for a good, solid neighborhood, quiet neighborhood, and something near the schools. I think people drive through Stonegate looking for upscale second homes, making sure that there's some overriding quality control and investment. I think if we were to drop one of these facilities in the middle of Stonegate, with 12 or more students, that would be an issue that would be heard loud and clear at this planning board. So my sense is there is certainly an impact on property values, and I think a lot of the realization of that impact depends upon how the facility operates. And I think it would be very difficult for this board, and it's actually something that more appropriately belongs with the zoning board, but I'm certainly not willing to sit here this evening and say that there would be a negative impact on property values, but I can understand certainly and clearly how that is another concern of the neighbors.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Any further comments or questions? Mr. Wilcox.
I have a question for the applicant about the parking facilities, and more of the parking procedures, I guess. And one of the things I was wondering if it has come to light at this point in time yet, or if it is an issue, is there on-street parking on Scott Dyer Road in front of your proposed facility, and how do you plan to address?
There is no parking on Scott Dyer Road. Actually, there's not even a walkway on Scott Dyer Road on our side of the road anyway. All the way up on the opposite side of the road where the Viking community is. We're located, the way they're going to have to come in is either come up west or east down into the driveway and pull all the way around the big circle we have here, and they're going to end up having to park towards the end of the driveway where they just came in, just in case. Well, when we write up our policies and procedures for the daycare, that's exactly, they're not just going to be able to pull in and stop, because then that's going to cause the traffic problem out on Scott Dyer. So they will be told exactly
the policies that we want them in procedures to follow, which is to drive all the way in, don't stop in front and drop them off yet. Go all the way around and park on the opposite side of the circle, then get out of your cars and walk your children in to the facility, and then come back out. And then you're the first person in line, and the next, and so on, and all the way out.
So there won't be on-street parking on
no.
the entire road?
No. Or Patricia.
Okay. Thank you.
For that matter.
Great. Any further comments or questions? I understood from Mr. Azzolina's earlier comments that he was quite concerned about the lack of a current traffic study, that the latest one that we've had is 1990. Is there any further discussion on that particular issue? Okay. Anything further that people have on their minds? Mr. Evans.
I propose a motion. Finding the facts. One, Dana Rancourt and Lisa Manini are proposing to operate a daycare facility to be located at 111 Scott Dyer Road, which requires site plan review under Section 19-9-2. Two, the application was deemed complete on September 16, 1997, and a public hearing was held on October 21, 1997. Third, the application substantially complies with site plan standards, Section 19-9-5. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dana Rancourt and Lisa Manini for a site plan review of a proposed daycare facility to be operated at 111 Scott Dyer Road be granted subject to the following condition. One, that the daycare facility is approved for up to 12 students.
Could I suggest that it be no more than 12 students?
For no more than 12 students.
Or no more than 12 children.
12 children. Two, that the plans be revised and submitted to the town planner for review prior to the issuance of a building permit or opening of the daycare facility. Is it assumed that those revised plans will incorporate the buffering? Shall we add that as a condition? That a minimum of 10 feet be maintained between the edge of pavement and the adjacent property line. And that's particularly at the upper left-hand or the upper parking space. And that the hours of operation and days of operation be as stipulated by the Zoning Board of Approval. That a clearly marked crosswalk with appropriate signage be provided between the daycare, proposed daycare facility and the Viking to be coordinated with the owners of each and the Director of Public Works for the town. And is on-street parking an issue in terms of a condition? The applicant has stated that there'll be no on-street parking on Scott Dyer Road or on Patricia Drive.
I want to be heard on that.
There is a separate ordinance that the council regulates on-street parking, and it's not allowed on Scott Dyer Road.
Okay. That's all. Oh, I'm sorry.
Do you want to say anything about the shrubs or the fence or the driveway configuration?
The applicant had already indicated that the fence will be a stockade fence.
Is that listed on the plan, though?
Let's add it, that the proposed fence be labeled as a stockade fence of appropriate height. And that the easterly turning radius and the entering driveway or the driveway be similar to the exiting or left-hand radius, 15 feet as indicated on the plan.
And the shrubs?
And that the shrubs shall be noted as to be transplanted, and if they do not survive, that they'll be replaced with nursery-grown stock.
And that all such conditions be noted on the plan?
That's correct. That's correct. That the zoning board conditions be noted on the plan.
Is there a second to Mr. Emery's motion?
Second.
Mr. Parker, thank you. Any further discussion?
I would like to ask Mr. Emery considering another amendment that an updated traffic impact study be completed by the appropriate traffic engineer, indicating that there is no hazardous traffic condition would be encountered by the proposed traffic flow on Scott Dyer Road of this project.
Is there a second to Mr. Azzolini's amendment? I'm not sure you're getting a lot of help tonight, Mr. Azzolini.
I would just, is it appropriate to respond to that?
Please.
I think the issue with the size of facility that's proposed in terms of the management of the traffic could be monitored and impacts could be seen. However, given the relatively small size of the facility at this time relative to something much larger, I'm not sure that a traffic report would show a significant impact for this particular use, and particularly in light of the operation across the street and in context with the recently approved project. But I would fully support a traffic report for any future increase in population for the facility. But I don't think that needs to be a condition of approval.
At the risk of being branded as unduly argumentative, I'll withdraw the suggested amendment.
Any further comment? Yes, Mr. Parkhurst.
You mentioned appropriate height for the fence. Weren't we referring to a 6-foot high fence before?
I'm not real comfortable specifying a height of a fence. I think that's up to the applicant and their insurance people. As far as I can see from the plan, the only way from the fence is back through the house, and I'm not sure that's a safe situation. I think there should be another way out of the fence, and I don't know how high the fence has to be to avoid people from getting over it and so forth. It may be necessary that they have an 8-foot fence. I don't know.
Are you talking about the fence around the play area?
Yes.
And what was the issue?
Height.
It's not specified, is it?
The proposed condition on the motion right now is that there be a fence of appropriate height, quote unquote, and the discussion was whether to specify a particular
actual height.
Have the neighbors to the rear concerns about noise been addressed appropriately as far as people are concerned? Okay.
I think that's what I was trying to get at with a 6-foot high fence as opposed to a 4-foot high fence or something. It would just be that much more of a buffer for them.
You want to say something like significant? I mean,
I'm not an engineer. I'm not so sure that I can really put forth a good argument for that, what I just said. I'm not sure if a 4-foot fence is going to do a better job for short little people or a 6-foot high fence will do the job. I'm not sure.
Well, I certainly would support not less than 4 feet.
I doubt that we need to specify that. I think we could probably leave a 4 feet as appropriate.
Would you support 6 feet?
Not necessarily. I don't.
Well, what's the difference between no less than 4 and 6?
If we have to come up with a number, I'll say 6 feet, if it's important to come up with a number.
Mr. Wilcox?
4-foot high fence would probably have would obviously have less impact on noise. I would think if But on the other hand, if you actually were to go out with sound meters, a six-foot-high fence probably doesn't do a heck of a lot more, but psychologically makes a big difference in terms of line of sight. So I think the appropriate height language thing would puts still gives the applicant some freedom and not subject to total tyranny of the planning board, and could be if and I think that the word reasonable might be something that is sort of implied by appropriate height and given
reasonably
the other
appropriate height.
Well, I think the word appropriate implies that it's reasonable, and that works for me.
Any further discussion?
What was the conclusion of that discussion?
I think that the
I think appropriate stands.
Appropriate.
This is appropriate and nothing further, and Mr. Azzolino has withdrawn his suggested amendment to the motion, so the motion stands as voiced by Mr. Emery and seconded by Mr. Parkhurst. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All opposed? It's unanimous. Congratulations to the applicant. Best wishes. And you know that the plan needs to be appropriately revised and submitted to the town planner for approval before a building permit can be issued. Thank you very much, and thank all the people who spoke at the planning at the public hearing for coming and giving us your thoughts. This is the only item on the agenda for the formal planning board meeting this evening, so without further ado, do I hear a motion to adjourn the meeting of the board?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? It's unanimous. We will now adjourn for an informal session to the
informal
town hall conference room. That's